this is Simone, and welcome to Arodri Travels Angels and Demons Tour. So what we're going to do is follow the footsteps of Robert Langton, minus the tweed jacket, and take the path of the Illuminati to the four altars of science, followed by the other locations that are mentioned in the novel. Now, it won't be as exciting as in the book. We're not exactly chasing cardinal assassins, and the Vatican is not exactly in danger of being blown up by a minuscule antimatter. I also won't be showing you the Sistine Chapel because, as you know, you cannot bring cameras inside. I know, that kind of sucks. Now, these places I'll show you are not just made famous by Dan Brown's novel. They already are famous and important in their own right. So on these tours, we'll visit the places in detail so you understand them not only from the novel's perspective, but also for their rich historic, artistic, and cultural significance. Last and not least, we can't leave out the Illuminati. Who was this secret society, and what did it have to do with religion and science? We'll separate fact from fiction and finish it off with Galileo's last grand gesture on this matter. The Kitty Chapel inside the Church of Santa Maria del Popolo is where the first altar of science that represents Earth is. The first cardinal in the novel was killed beneath the church, suffocated with soil lodged in his throat. So now we're going to go visit the chapel and the church itself because it's a fabulous, fabulous place. So follow me.
One name that remains constant throughout the four altars of science is Bernini, one of the greatest sculptors and architects that ever lived. We'll talk about Bernini later on in the shows, but as we're standing here in front of Santa Maria del Popolo, looking at its facade, we can see the work of Bernini, even before we go inside. Santa Maria del Popolo went through a few transformations since it was first built, but it's well known for its treasured works of art by Raphael, Caravaggio, and of course Bernini. It has some unusual tombs, enough symbols to keep Robert Langton busy till retirement, and its legendary haunting beginnings still spook people today. Boy, I can't wait to go in. When I walked into this church, first thing that caught my eye was the floor. No smooth, polished marble patterns and designs here, oh no. Just smoothly polished off faces on tomb covers, depicting whoever decided it was a good idea to be buried where, surely, they'd be trampled over. But, I guess, if you're gonna let people walk all over you, it's best to let them after you're dead. The other thing I noticed inside the church was a high concentration of skulls, many of them with wings. I was starting to get the heebie-jeebies, as if walking on dead people's marble faces on their tombs wasn't creepy enough. And all this before I even made it to the Kitty Chapel. On a previous visit to Rome, I met a friend, Kate, who is also a guide, and she was able to shed some light on some of the peculiar things about this church that I never imagined, mostly surrounding the subject of death.
That unlike any other churches, there's a lot of skeleton symbols here.
It's a particularity of this church, but in many churches you can find these skeletons with the bones.
With the crossbones, yes.
Crossbones. But in this church there is a particular number of these, because it's a particular church in the center of Rome, and kind of prestige to be buried in this church. So many members of the clergy, many members of the nobility of Rome were buried here for their choice.
And these tombs underground, mm-hmm. It's where they're buried?
Yes, it's a tomb, but the bones are not under, because they are the fundament of the church. But the person are buried underground.
Underneath the church?
Underneath. when you find the skeleton or the skull with the bones, it's a symbol of death.
Okay.
And in a particular period of Italian culture, from the final part of the 17th century until the 18th century, there is the Baroque culture, so there is a particular sensibility towards death. And so you can find the skeleton like a memento mori, that in Latin, the ancient Italian, is remember that you have to die. So it's like a monitor for the person that come into the church to remember to people that they can be forever alive, that they should die. When you find, however, this kind of...
like on the column, it's like a skull with wings.
Wings. It's another particular significance, because the skull is the symbol of death. And when he has wings, it means that the death comes quickly, like with wings. And you don't know when and why death comes, so it's better to be prepared at this moment. So in all this explication, you can say memento mori in Latin. And there is also a particular positive significance to become all these tombs less scary than they appear. And if you want, I can show you the skeleton with the bones in
the crossbones.
The crossbones are MDL, M, 16th century.
Okay.
When you find wings, it's almost the 17th century.
Okay.
Because it's a particular culture of the 17th century. It's particular.
Yeah, with a woman, that's a little spooky.
Yes, it's a spooky.
Like it's gonna go boom.
But there's also another significance that is very positive, because the person that is buried here, that is Giovanni Battista Gisleni, as you read in the first line, is the person that did this sculpture.
He sculpted this?
Yes, sculpted this.
For his own tomb?
For his own tomb. And also to remember to himself that he had to die. But all these epitaphs say that he was a person full of life, and so when he died, he said, when you visit my tomb, don't clap at me, but don't cry for me. Just when you come, say hello, and when you came out, say goodbye. A kind of thing to remember him and his art. So this is the death imprisoned, because he knows that never vivus, neither I can be alive forever, but never illiquotus, nor I can die forever, because he hopes in another life after death, a rebirth. As you will look here, there is a cocoon in Idulo Memoria. In my cocoon I will die. But with Phoenix Multiplicabudis, as a phoenix, I can be born again. So this is a butterfly that seems to die, but it will revert to a better life after the apparent death.
Very symbolic.
Yes, very symbolic. So the death is not so scary, but is imprisoned with a hope for the future.
This one here is a dragon.
Yes, this is a dragon, but it's here only because it's symbol of the family.
Okay.
So if you look, Maria Eleonora Boncompagni Ludovisi. Boncompagni Ludovisi is the surname. And the coat of arms is with dragon here, because it is a symbol of this family. And
Interesting.
Moseyed over to the Chigi Chapel. And lucky for me, I was able to see it when the Chigi Chapel didn't look like it was still a part of the movie set and the crew forgot to take off the props. Now, I don't know if the chapel is in real need of repair
or the church is trying to discourage the onslaught of angels and demons fans in large tour groups from hoarding the chapel. Anyway, according to the Angels and Demons novel, the Kiji Chapel is Santi's earthly tomb, covered in pagan and apparently Illuminati symbols, including the demon hole, which, as it turned out, wasn't inside the pantheon after all. This was a private mortuary chapel belonging to Agostino Chigi, a prominent banker from Siena with more money than the Pope. He was also a generous patron of Renaissance art, as well as the patron of Raphael, whom he commissioned to design his chapel. Unfortunately, both patron and artist died before the chapel was even completed, and so the work was passed on to Gian Lorenzo Bernini by his patron, Fabio Chigi, who was Agostino's great-grandson, who also became Pope Alexander VII. And so, the chapel was completed a century after Raphael's death. The work attributed to Raphael, like the mosaics and the statues of Jonas and Elijah, were done by other artists based on his cartoons and sketches. The two pyramids, monuments to Agostino Chigi and his brother Sigismondo, as well as the statues of Prophet Habakkuk and Angel, as well as Prophet Daniel, were created by Bernini. If you look above, you'll notice a spectacular dome reminiscent of the one in St. Peter's, but at a much smaller scale. And it's really got a lot going on. There are four painted medallions of the allegories of the seasons. And from Raphael's drawings, mosaics representing the creation of the world surrounded by the sun and seven classical planets, each moved by an angel. In the center of the dome is a mosaic of God in the act of creating, which also resembles the creation fresco in the Sistine Chapel by Michelangelo. On the floor beneath the dome is a creepy skeleton manhole with an inscription that reads, Mors ad Caelos, which loosely translates to something like, from death to heaven.
The Kiji Chapel,
yes,
was Kiji. Made very famous by Dan Brown.
The Angels and Demons.
Yes. Have people been asking you about that?
Many people.
So what do you tell them?
It's a fantasy, mm-hmm. because I didn't read the book, but other person that work with me that have read this book told me that there is no real parallel. Also, many things are just invented to obtain a proposal.
To make the story interesting, yes.
Yes, okay. So interesting. Yes, it's true that the Kiji Chapel is full of symbol and many strange things. For example, in the dome, with the god at the center and allegory of the seven planets all around. Seven planets are pagan gods. So pagan gods with God, the Christian God, is not typical parallel. So in this chapel, it's possible to see this thing because the property of the chapel was of Agostino Chigi, that is the person that is buried in the right pyramid. And he was very addicted to astronomy and so on. So he believed in the power of fortune, of the stars and of the planets above our lives. So he tried to reconstruct in this chapel this kind of philosophy that he had. But he knew that our soul, when the body is dead, only the soul is still alive, because he was a Christian, and the soul has to go again to God. So there is a special mix between these two cultures, pagan and Christian, what is linked to Agostino Chigi and his philosophy. Also under the chapel, under the hall, the Bernini Hall, and under there is nothing.
There's something was there before?
Yes, the bones of the Chigi that now are moved. But it's a closed area, there is no passage and so on.
No, interesting. And that's another one with the lion?
Yes, another one.
This is so elaborate.
Yes, because it's Rococo. It's after the Baroque, so it's the best of Baroque. It's opulent.
Very.
And the noble woman that is in the circle is Maria Flaminia Odescalchi. The symbol of the family was the lion and the eagle. That is linked with another symbol of another family. It is the Chigi family, the sixth hill of Siena, and the tree that is a symbol of another family. So are all symbols of many families that are all linked one to the other.
Wow. Beautiful piece.
And this is another particular significance of that. This is a red curtain. It's like the fire of the life that is red. But when you are dead, it's freezed.
Fire just frozen face, okay. Like a statue.
Frozen, yes. And so all the curtain goes on your life.
It goes down.
Goes down on your life.
Like the end of the theater, the curtain
the
goes down, the end of the show.
End of the show.
No encore.
No. Little angels. Also, this angel is very particular. Any angels announce that. Trumpet, the trumpet of death. One another symbol of that is the snake.
Oh, the snake biting his tail. Mm-hmm. It's in a circle.
It's a particular symbol of regeneration, of rebirth.
The cycle of life.
Yes.
This church is very symbolic.
It's full of symbols. Number 8 is the number of eternal life.
Oh yeah, because when you turn it sideways, yes, it's a sign of eternity.
And also, if you know about the 7 days of the creation, the creation was made by God in 7 days. So a day more is the day of the life after life.
The eternal life.
Eternal life. And this church, if you look, there is many 8.
Oh.
4 chapel in that nave, 4
yes.
chapel in this other nave, so 8.
8. These columns?
These columns
pillars.
Are 8 elements. And also the Chigi chapel is octagonal.
Not all of them, though, just
no,
the Chigi chapel.
The Chigi chapel and this dome with the octagonal.
Oh, okay. Interesting. Does it feel a little spooky being in a church where there's tombs and death?
Yes, it's a little scary.
Yeah?
But...
No ghosts?
There is a legend. I don't know if you believe in ghosts. The priest tell me that there is a ghost of one person that is buried here, that many priests have seen him. He's a gentleman that when the church is closed, goes around the church, and many priests have seen it.
I'm just curious what it looked like, because I can't see the ghosts.
They say that it was very elegant, very sophisticated, with a monocle.
Oh yeah,
it was a person of that chapel, the Theodore.
Oh, okay.
So when we close the chapel, all the church at 7 o'clock in the evening, this priest said the church was closed. And when all the people were out, he looked with the eyes, a person. So he said, the church is closed. But he searched for him, looking for him, and there was nobody. When he went to the other Pregostinians, he told about this person, and everyone said, oh, was dressed like this, or was tall, was... Yes, it was that person. Okay, it's the Theodore man that came out. Theodore is that chapel, the chapel of the family Theodore.
If Santa Maria del Popolo is indeed haunted, it's not for the first time. Although Santa Maria del Popolo was built on the tomb of ancient Rome's Domitia family, a certain Emperor Nero was also buried there. And according to legend, the site was possessed by Nero's evil spirits and demons in the form of crows that tormented the people. So in 1099, Pope Pascal II chopped down a walnut tree that sheltered these demonic crows and consecrated the site by building a chapel over it dedicated to the Virgin Mary. Other legends have it that a skeleton manhole inside the Qiji Chapel was designed over a lid that supposedly covered the exit to the demon hole, and the altar covered the entrance into the demon hole. The chapel didn't become a church until the 13th century when Pope Gregory IX placed it in charge of the Augustinian order, who still oversees the church today. It was reconstructed again twice, the second time when Bernini modified the facade in a more contemporary Baroque style that was popular during that time. The Qiji Chapel is not the only work of art created by the masters of that time. To the left of the altar, there's also the Cherasi Chapel, dedicated to Saints Peter and Paul, where two large oil paintings are displayed, painted by none other than Caravaggio. The Crucifixion of Saint Peter. And Conversion of Paul. To preserve these masterpieces, the chapel is kept in the dark. To turn on the light, you place a coin in a small box just outside the chapel and the light turns on temporarily so you get a better view. In the next episode, we're going to visit Piazza del Popolo with its many Christian and pagan symbols and architecture, the ancient Roman gate into the city, and a very interesting place featuring Da Vinci, the other controversial figure in Dan Brown's other book, The Da Vinci Code. We'll also see where in Piazza del Popolo the movie Angels and Demons was filmed, because as you know, the Vatican banned them from filming inside any of Rome's churches. Thank you for watching. Until next time, ciao for now.